Hello to all of my friends, both near and far. I want to welcome everyone to another edition of the National Portrait Gallery Storytime program called Introducing. In this program, we share the stories of the people who've helped shape the history of the United States through our portraits. Now, today, I am elated to share this black and white photograph of pianist, composer, and arranger, Mary Lou Williams, by Jean Méli from 1943. In this portrait, you see a knee-length view of an African-American woman facing three quarters to the right, playing the piano. She's wearing a dress with a deep V neckline, and we see two large flowers in her hair. We see an unidentified man in the foreground facing three quarters to the left, playing the bass. You'll see a microphone stand at left. And also in the background, we see unidentified men and women who are seated at tables with cocktails. Now, Mary Lou Williams was born as Mary Elfrida Scruggs in Atlanta, Georgia in 1910. Her family later moved to Pittsburgh when Mary Lou was four. She began to play the piano about the same time, learning first from her mother and then from the many pianists who frequented their home. She learned how to play ragtime, boogie woogie, and blues, and her family would even pay her sometimes to play their favorite songs. By the age of 15, Mary Lou Williams was on the road full time, playing with a small band that backed a vaudeville act known as Seymour and Jeanette. Now, Williams came to prominence in the late 1920s and 1930s as the principal composer, arranger, and pianist for musicians Andy Clark and his 12 Clouds of Joy, which enhanced her reputation by contributing to the big band sound of that particular time. And she worked with other musicians like Benny Goodman, Earl Hines, Tommy Dorsey, Duke Ellington, and even Dizzy Gillespie. By 1928, Mary Lou Williams was in Kansas City, Missouri, where she played with other prominent jazz musicians like Art Tatum and even a teenage Thelonious Monk. Mary Lou continued to play with the group The Clouds of Joy in the 1920s as a last-minute substitute for the regular pianist during the band's audition for a record executive. The record executive loved the group, but he was even more impressed with Williams and insisted she play on the record. She recorded six titles, four of which were written solely by her or with her and other people in the band. Her strong left hand could play a ragtime bass, boogie woogie, or swing, while her right hand added lovely melodies, sophisticated harmonies, and counter rhythms. Now, even though Williams was very talented, she still experienced discrimination because of her gender. Sometimes male musicians refused to play with her, or sometimes she even had to wait in the car while the band was performing, only coming in to play a popular boogie woogie piece or another if she knew the audience seemed receptive to a woman musician. Now, regardless of these difficult experiences, Mary Lou Williams became one of the great swing band pianist. Her powerful skills led her to be billed as the lady who swings the band. By 1945, she was leading an all-woman group and later became an important figure in the formation of the bebop movement, which was very new and unique for its time. Mary Lou Williams served as a mentor and friend to bebop musicians like, again, Thelonious Monk, Bud Powell, and Dizzy Gillespie. During this period, she also wrote compositions like Froggy Bottom, Roll'em, What's Your Story, Morning Glory, and In the Land of Ubladi. Now, frustrated by her experiences in the music industry, Williams actually moved to Europe in 1952, and retired from the music industry in 1954 to pursue religious and charitable activities. She moved to the French countryside for a while and then moved back to New York City, where she began a street ministry for struggling musicians. her apartment became almost like a rest home, complete with cots, and a soup kitchen. She established the Bel Canto Foundation to help needy musicians, ran a thrift shop to raise money, and used the profits from her own record company, which she started, which was called Mary Records, to support her work. She said that no one would record me, so I decided to record myself. Now, a few years later, she was encouraged by Dizzy Gillespie to return to her career. So in 1957, she appeared at the Newport Jazz Festival. By the early 1960s, she was again composing, focusing on her religious interests. She conducted musical workshops in storefronts and on college campuses, and appeared throughout the 60s and 70s in concert and on numerous radio and television programs, including The Today Show, Sesame Street, and Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. During the last decade of her life, she was honored with a Guggenheim Fellowship, which is a big deal. And from 1977 until shortly before the end of her life, was an artist in residence at Duke University in North Carolina, where she taught jazz history and led the jazz orchestra. Now, sadly, we've reached the end of this week's introducing. I hope you enjoyed learning about this amazing woman as much as I have. Until then, we hope to see you back next Wednesday for a new story.